The House Select Committee investigating the U.S. Capitol insurrection expected to hand down another subpoena today, this time for John Eastman, a conservative lawyer who worked with former President Trump's legal team.
The committee says Eastman tried to convince then Vice President Pence that he could overturn the election results, which of course Pence could not legally and ultimately decided not to do. But now, in a conversation caught on camera by a Democratic activist posing as a Trump supporter, Eastman admits on tape that was indeed the plan. Have a watch.
But I mean, like, you know, just supporter to supporter, like, why do you think that Mike Pence didn't do it?
Well, because Mike Pence is an establishment guy at the end of the day. And all of the establishment Republicans in D.C. bought into this very myopic view that Trump was destroying the Republican Party. And what Trump was doing is destroying the inside the Beltway Republican Party and reviving the Republican Party in the hinterland, right? What they all consider to be, you know, deplorable flyover country. And this uprising that Trump got ahead of, he didn't create the movement. The movement was there, and he saw it and got ahead of it.
CNN reached out this morning to Eastman's office for comment. We will update you if and when CNN hears back. But let's talk about the significance of this, being caught on camera, describing, it seems, Ellie, our CNN senior legal analyst, former U.S. attorney, Ellie Honig. Ellie, Eastman, after the memo that he drafted, describing exactly this plan as to how the president could overturn the election, he then did an interview with the National Review Online, said, no, that's not, never intended to do that. Here you have him on tape saying, that's exactly what we intended to do, in effect. And the only reason Pence stood in the way of this is that he's, in Eastman's terms, an establishment guy. You're a lawyer. How damning is this video for both for the investigation or any other investigation into the 2020 election?
Well, it's completely damning for John Eastman, Jim. And let's step back and remember who John Eastman is. So he's this lawyer who Trump discovers right when he's in the process of trying to steal the election. And Eastman starts telling Trump these really lunatic legal theories, I put legal theories in scare quotes here, on which Mike Pence can reject the electoral count. He writes this two-page memo. It's full of lies, including this allegation that seven different states have put forward competing slates of electors. Not true, and it gets worse from there. Eastman's memo says that at some point Mike Pence can, and I quote, gavel Trump as president, as if the vice president has the legal authority to just bang a gavel and say he's reelected. It's crazy stuff. Then Eastman goes and does this self-serving interview with the National Review where he says, no, I was trying to talk Trump down. I was just laying out a hypothetical, even though that's not the language in the actual memo. And he even says, Eastman says, I don't remember who asked me to even write this memo. Well, this tape really brings us back to reality, which is Eastman meant what he said in the memo. He was right there with Trump trying to lead him down this very dangerous path.
What's interesting, too, is as we look at this potential subpoena and what could be learned from John Eastman. Jamie Raskin, who of course serves on the panel, told CNN the committee needs to determine to what extent there was an organized effort against Vice President Pence, which would obviously imply more than just write this memo and more than just John Eastman, Ellie.
Yeah, Eastman's memo really is the sort of legalistic version of what we heard those people chanting in the Capitol, hang Mike Pence. I mean, Eastman is saying Mike Pence can and should do this under the Constitution. That's what it says in the memo. That's what Eastman tried to walk back. Again, Eastman tried to talk to the National Review and tell them, no, I was just sort of spinning hypotheticals. That's not what the memo says, and that's not what we just heard Eastman say in that tape. Eastman very much meant exactly the words he put on paper, which were Mike Pence has the power to do this, which he does not, and that Mike Pence essentially should be blamed if he declines to do this, as thankfully he did.
Ellie, can you help me understand, and maybe some of our viewers share this frustration or lack of understanding here. You have Eastman on tape saying this. You have former President Trump taped on a phone call saying, find me the votes in Georgia. In effect, audio and video evidence of potential crimes in the offing. Why these many months later has this seemed to not have led anywhere legally, in terms of legal consequences?
I completely share that frustration and that mystification. I mean, look, Congress is doing its job or trying to do its job. Mm-hmm. The January 6th committee is sending out subpoenas. They're engaging in court battles. They're trying to get some truth. But the question that I think a lot of people have that I have is, where's DOJ in all this? Where's Merrick Garland in all this? Because at the end of the day, all the January 6th committee can do, it's very important, is make findings of fact, issue a report. We need that report. However, consequences, that can only come from prosecutors. I think we have more than enough basis on which Merrick Garland needs to be taking a very serious criminal look here.
Joining us now, CNN legal and national security analyst Asha Rangappa and CNN's Dana Bash. Good to have both of you. Asha, let me start with you. This video is important because for those Republicans who say, and we heard this from Secretary Rice over the weekend, it's time to move on from January 6th. The same people who sold the lie leading up to the insurrection are still selling that lie to people who are believing that, pushing that narrative forward.
Yes, Victor. And I think that lawyers are leading the charge, and Eastman is one of those lawyers. And this is especially dangerous for two reasons. The first is that when lawyers provide a baseless legal theory, as Eastman did in this case, to essentially overturn the election, his idea was that Mike Pence could basically throw out the Electoral Count Act, which he cannot do, and override the Constitution, which he cannot do. When lawyers provide a baseless legal theory like that, they are giving legal cover and permission for other people to follow along. And then secondly, they're weaponizing the law against the very principles that it is meant to protect. And we've seen this before, for example, with the torture memos by the former head of the Office of Legal Counsel, John Yoo. These are very dangerous for our democracy. And I think the legal profession has a reckoning on what to do with these lawyers who are violating their, you know, legal professional responsibility to uphold the rule of law and misusing their skills and credentials and authority.
Yeah, Dan, I mean, we've learned from the leaked Facebook documents that when people in positions of authority, like John Eastman, but particularly politicians, say misinformation and say crazy things, they're given more weight, and the public believes them more than they believe their neighbor saying something like that. And then we've seen it catch fire. And by the way, this happens all the time. And what we're seeing now that politicians are trying to do is whitewash what happened on January 6th and keep pretending that it was no big deal. It was just a protest. So here's just a little bit of sound.
If you didn't know the TV footage was a video from January the 6th, you would actually think it was a normal tourist visit.
By and large, it was peaceful protests, except for, you know, there were a number of people, basically agitators, that whipped the crowd and breached the Capitol.
I knew those are people that love this country, that truly respect law enforcement, would never do anything to break a law, and so I wasn't concerned.
January 6th was just a riot at the Capitol. And if you think about what our Declaration of Independence says, it says to overthrow tyrants.
I mean, they're just going on. So it started in May. That sort of whitewashing has continued. You hear the freshman congresswoman from Georgia just coming up with her newest angle on this.
It's just a riot.
And it's also just from the Declaration of Independence that you're supposed to actually do that. Dana.
Yeah, and you do see the evolution or the differences. And it does seem that Marjorie Taylor Greene's argument, as out there and outlandish as it is different from the other ones who were just trying to say what you're seeing, the images that you're seeing, and to their colleagues, what you experienced firsthand, and never mind our friends and colleagues in the press corps, didn't actually happen. What she is saying is actually it did happen. There was a riot. There was an insurrection. And that was their constitutional right to do that. That's exactly what was encouraged by and since the founding of America, which is also just kind of mind-blowing. And it does seem as though that argument is the one that is still has a lot of resonance with the people that she is speaking to. And they are the same people that the former president is speaking to. And there are a lot, and there really is a good amount of support for that in the Republican base, which is driving a lot of decisions by local lawmakers in these states, which I know we'll talk about, to change the way this is done in the future.